आज की छोटी सी बैठक ये हम लोगों ने बहुत आनंद फानंद में तय की और लगा कि इस पे कोई बात करना जरूरी जरूर है, तो इसलिए बहुत कम नोटिस में किया और जितने लोग भी आ पाए हैं तो वी आर एक्सट्रीमली ग्रेटफुल टू देम। तो शुरू में मैं इन्वाइट करना चाहूंगा सब लोगों को सामने, पॉल कृपया सामने आ जाए, असीम आप ही आ जाए सामने। कुछ लोग जो एजेंडा पे नाम है वो हम लोगों से अभी थोड़ी देर में जुड़ जाएंगे, जैसे हिमांशु हैं, दुनू हैं, केपी सक्सेना साहब हैं, अभय आप ही आगे आए। नहीं नहीं यहाँ पे थोड़ा ठीक रहता है। वी ऑल्सो होप दैट राखी विल बी एबल टू ज्वाइन अस इन सम टाइम एंड प्रकाश, राखी और प्रकाश भी थोड़ी देर तक लोगों को ज्वाइन करें। असीम, पॉल, अभय कृपया सामने आए, विजय जी कृपया आप भी सामने आए। और आपसे आग्रह ये है कि आप ये हम लोग बैठक क्यों कर रहे हैं, और विजय जी, हाँ गोपा, सॉरी गोपा प्लीज कम फॉरवर्ड, क्या आई एम सॉरी, विजय जी से ये रिक्वेस्ट है टू ले द बैकग्राउंड और ऑल्सो वेलकम पीपल ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ बियॉन्ड कोपेनहेगन एंड अदर को ऑर्गेनाइजर्स। विजय जी को ये जिम्मेदारी एक तो हमारे वरिष्ठ साथी होने के नाते और एक बियॉन्ड कोपेनहेगन के कन्वीनर हैं ये उनके नाते, तो जरूर आए और आगे की बातचीत जो है वो आपके मार्गदर्शन में हो।
के तौर पे अजय जी का उसमें बहुत यकीन है। मेरे को लग रहा है कि मैं बहुत लंबी चौड़ी भूमिका नहीं, इतना ही कहना चाहूंगा कि अपने यहाँ वोट मैनिफेस्टो पे दिया जाने लगा है, लोग उसको काफी गंभीरता से लेते हैं। इसी की वजह है कि कई दिन तक बीजेपी के शीर्ष नेतृत्व में आपस में झगड़ा होता रहा और कई दिन तक वो मैनिफेस्टो पब्लिक डोमेन में नहीं आ पाया। छन के बातें आ रही थी कि मुरली मनोहर जोशी को किस चीज पे एतराज है और नरेंद्र मोदी उसमें क्या करवाना चाहते हैं, लेकिन ये जो मैनिफेस्टो गंभीरता से लिया जाता है ये केवल ये नागरिक समाज, हम लोग अपने आप को नागरिक समाज कहते हैं और नागरिकों के लिए ही ये गंभीरता से लिया जाता है। और देश में एक बड़ा हिस्सा है जिसको कोई भी डेमोक्रेसी के राइट्स पूरे तौर पे एक इंसानी तौर पे उपलब्ध नहीं है, उनको इज्जतपूर्ण रोजगार उपलब्ध नहीं है, इसलिए हम मनरेगा लाते हैं, उनको स्वास्थ्य सेवाएं उपलब्ध नहीं है, पुरानी जो ज्ञान परंपराएं हैं स्वास्थ्य के बारे में उनको डीलेजिटिमाइज करने के साथ साथ उनको खत्म भी किया गया है। नए नारे इस ढंग से आते हैं जैसे यूनिवर्सल एक्सेस टू हेल्थ केयर में कैसे अपने ज्ञान को और जो फोक नॉलेज एग्जिस्टिंग है उसको कैसे समझना है, डॉक्यूमेंटेशन करना है, इसके बारे में आमतौर से सब मैनिफेस्टोस मौन हैं, आम आदमी पार्टी में कुछ संकेत है, और बीजेपी वालों ने शुरू में आयुष कहा है, विच इंक्लूड्स ऑल दी पैथीज नॉन मॉडर्न मेडिसिन, लेकिन फिर आयुर्वेद पे आ गए, अंत भी आयुर्वेद से किया है एक आधी जगह, यानी वहां भी जो नॉलेज की प्लुरलिटी है उसका सम्मान नहीं है, उनकी जो अपनी समझ है ये भारतीय और ये विदेशी है। तो इस तरह की चीजें सब मैनिफेस्टोस को एक साथ पढ़ने के बाद जो सबसे बड़ा साइलेंस है, बहुत एलिक्वेंट है, वो नॉलेज डेमोक्रेसी के बारे में है, लोगों के जो एम्पावरिंग चीजें हैं उसके बारे में ये टोटली साइलेंट है सबके सब मैनिफेस्टोस। दूसरा एलिक्वेंट साइलेंस है कि ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन को मैनेजेरियल, इकोनॉमिक मैनेजेरियल चीज माना गया है, उसमें जो पूरी मानव सभ्यता के लिए वही ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन हो सकता है जिसमें जो विक्टिम है वो खुद से भी हिस्सेदारी करे, उसका भी नेतृत्व विकसित होने की एक लोकतांत्रिक गुंजाइश रहे, तो जिसको अब एनजीओ वाले सोशल कैपिटल कहते हैं, तो वो यूनियनाइजेशन, उसका डीलेजिटिमाइजेशन, यूनियनाइजेशन ऑफ पुअर के बगैर हिंदुस्तान में पावर्टी खत्म नहीं हो सकती, हिंदुस्तान में सस्टेनेबिलिटी का जो पूरी दुनिया का संकट है वो यूनियनाइजेशन, जो रीइमेजिनिंग कम्युनिटी भी उस यूनियनाइजेशन का हिस्सा है, इसके बारे में सब एक तरह का यूनेनिमस नॉन अंडरस्टैंडिंग है, देयर इज नो रेफरेंस व्हाटसोएवर, इवन इनडायरेक्ट रेफरेंस, जबकि हम लोग जो भी काम करते हैं उसमें मेरी तो विनम्र राय ये है कि बिना लोगों के अपने हाथ में अपनी कमान लिए, अपने संघर्ष की कमान लिए कोई मैनिफेस्टो लागू नहीं हो सकता। तीसरी बात जो मैं एक बैकग्राउंड के तौर पे कहना चाहता हूँ कि मैंने कहा मैनिफेस्टो उसको गंभीरता से लिया जा रहा है, लेकिन उन्हीं लोगों को लिया, उन्हीं लोगों में गंभीरता से लिया जाता है जो जो डेमोक्रेसी को नागरिक के तौर पे भुगत रहे हैं। अभी मैं किशनगंज में था तो मैंने ऋतु जी से कहा कि मुझे वहां का डेटा निकाल के जो उपलब्ध आंकड़े उनके आधार पे एक पीपल्स मैनिफेस्टो में क्या मुद्दे आने चाहिए ऐसा नोट बना के दीजिए, तो आप यकीन मानिए कि उनके लिए संभव नहीं था, इमोशनली वो आधा दिन डिस्टर्ब रही। 94% लोग गरीबी रेखा से नीचे हैं, बीपीएल, और ये अकेला जिला नहीं है, ऐसे बिहार में 36 जिले चिन्हित हैं। प्लानिंग कमीशन ने जब बैकवर्ड को कराई थी तो mid-80s में 100 कुछ थे, 60 थे शायद, अब वो 200+ जिले हैं जो पिछड़े माने जाते हैं, जिसमें स्वास्थ्य, जिसमें कुपोषण, जिसमें गरीबी रेखा से नीचे होना, तो उनके लिए भी पार्टियों में एक सहमति है कि इनको इन चीजों पे एजुकेट ही नहीं करना, इसलिए हिंदुत्व को किस कभी सटल और कभी अनसटल, उसमें ओबीसी जातियां, उसमें जैसे मतलब जो तमाम रीजनल पार्टीज हैं उसमें ओबीसी और दलित के आधार पे, और अब पहले हिंदुत्व वाली थी, मैं ये आखिरी बात खत्म करके कोशिश करूंगा अपनी बात का सार अंग्रेजी में भी कहने का। फादर रिलोक्सिस हैं और भी कई मित्र हैं जो उनसे क्षमा मांगते हुए कि मैं अंग्रेजी में नहीं बोला, तो आखिरी बात मैं सिर्फ यही कहना चाहता हूँ कि देश में जो अंधअस्मितावाद के बहाने से अस्मितावाद, अस्मिता का एक महत्व है, हर अस्मिता को इज्जतपूर्ण ढंग से, चाहे वो धर्म के आधार पे हो, अंचल के आधार पे हो, भाषा के आधार पे हो, हम लोगों का जो भारतीय सभ्यता है उसमें अस्मिताओं के लिए सदा जगह रही है। अभी अशोक वाजपेयी एक जगह बोलते हुए कह रहे थे कि हमारी भाषा भाषा संस्कार में ही सब चीजें बहुवचन में कही जाती हैं, एक वचन उसमें है ही नहीं। तो ये लेकिन मैं जिस परेशानी की ओर कि मैंने कहा कि मैनिफेस्टो सीरियसली लिया जाता है, दूसरी ओर ऐसा है कि एक कोशिश रामविलास जी हो या मायावती जी हो या मुलायम सिंह हो या नीतीश हो या दक्षिण की रीजनल पार्टीज हो, सबकी कोशिश कहीं ना कहीं मुद्दों पे बहस करने की बजाय अस्मिता के अस्मिता आधारित सपने, विवेक शून्य अस्मिता हो जिसमें एक ही एकांगी ढंग से जो है अस्मिता के बारे में बात की जाए ताकि मुद्दे बहस में आ ही ना सके, ये जो उन लोगों के लिए फिर मैनिफेस्टो नहीं लिखा जाता है। और ऐसी कुछ पार्टियां हैं जिनके जिनका होना ही अपने आप में उनका मैनिफेस्टो है। तो ये एक तरह का हमारा बहुस्तरीय जटिल सामाजिक स्थिति है, उस संदर्भ में हम लोग आज इन मैनिफेस्टोस के बारे में बात कर रहे हैं और जिस तरह के अलग अलग पृष्ठभूमियों के हम लोग हैं तो उसमें कोई एक आइडियोलॉजिकल हिसाब से या एक तरह की कसौटियों से अकादमिक ढंग से इस मैनिफेस्टो पे आप कमेंट करें ऐसी हमारी अपेक्षा नहीं है। एक नागरिक के नाते राजनीतिक रूप से वोट होना है जो 12 मई तक अलग अलग चरणों में कुछ हो चुका है, तो उसमें आपको जो सबसे महत्वपूर्ण बात लगती है उसको आप रेखांकित करेंगे, वो चाहे मौन की हो चाहे कही गई हो, तो वही इस बहस को आगे चलाएगा और 12 मई के बाद इन बहसों को अपने को कैसे सामाजिक स्तर पे गली मोहल्ले में चाय की दुकान पे नाई की दुकान पे भी ये बहस हो पाए, उसके लिए हमारे पास अगर कोई सुझाव हो तो वो अपने विश्लेषण के साथ साथ उस सुझाव को भी आप रखेंगे। और इसमें अगर आप में हम मैं देख रहा हूँ कि अपने कुछ साथी ऐसे हैं जो इंटरनेशनल जो डायमेंशंस हैं, कैसे ग्लोबल फाइनेंशियल कैपिटल हमारे को और डिसएम्पावर करता चला जा रहा है, उसमें असीम है, है आप हैं, तो आप सब लोग उस पर ही फोकस करेंगे क्योंकि उस पे कम विशेषज्ञ हम लोगों को मिलते हैं और हमारी जानकारी जीरो है या माइनस है, कई तरह के भ्रम भी हैं इस मायने में माइनस भी है, तो वो उस पे आप हमको एजुकेट करेंगे तो अच्छा होगा। ये सब बातें रिकॉर्ड की जा रही हैं और हमारी साथी विजया उसके नोट्स भी ले रही हैं, हम लोग कोशिश करेंगे कि जल्दी ही आपका ट्रांसक्रिप्शन आपको भेजा जाए तो फिर उसको आप ठीक करके हमको भेजेंगे तो रिजल्ट से पहले अपने पास कुछ फिनिश बात हो, आपका लिखा आपके पास होगा और आप स्वतंत्र हैं कि आप आज की बातचीत के बाद आज जो बोलेंगे उस राय को मॉडिफाई करके भी आज अंतिम सत्य ना बोलें, पेनल्टीमेट ट्रूथ बोल लें और अल्टीमेट ट्रूथ जो है जब आप हमको नोट करेक्ट करके भेजेंगे तब भेजते। मैं कोशिश करता हूँ, असीम भाई आप अंग्रेजी में पैराफ्रेज कर सकते हैं। हाँ नहीं मैं ये इंट्रोडक्टरी था तो
तुमने सुना
नहीं पे वो अच्छा रहेगा, अच्छा रहेगा, फालतू बात छट जाएगी।
आप कुछ
नहीं नहीं आप करिए, मेरी अंग्रेजी भी थोड़ा हाथ पाएंगे
जिनसे आपको पहले बताना, दो तीन चीजें मुझे याद नहीं।
हाँ वो जो याद है वो बाकी मैं जोड़ दूँ, वैसे ये सही है कि पहले
नहीं 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 लेट मी ट्राई, आई एम नॉट श्योर आई कैन डू जस्टिस टू दिस। द इम्पोर्टेंस ऑफ मैनिफेस्टोज हैज ग्रोन इन दिस इलेक्शन एंड अ लॉट ऑफ पीपल हु रिगार्ड देमसेल्व्स एज सिटीजन्स और सिटी ड्वेलर्स लुक अपॉन मैनिफेस्टोज सीरियसली, take it seriously it seems, and if Vijayabhai is right then they are voting on the basis of what they are reading and interpreting from the manifesto. None of the parties seem to have laid out a truly democratic path of how any of the goals are going to be achieved. None of the promises made seem to involve the participation of the people for whom those promises are meant. This is, I suppose, an aspect of exclusion, a fundamental aspect of exclusion of people from the very processes of decision making. The objective conditions in which people are living, we are all familiar with, or maybe not. Sometimes we tend to forget. Some of the surveys that have been done recently, and the one that Vijay Bhai pointed to from Kishanganj in Bihar, seems to suggest that 94% of people are living below the poverty line. And this is probably true of a few hundred districts in the country. It is not an anomaly. But the manifestos don't seem to reveal the kind of depth of concern that warrants.
Oh, yeah, Bilal.
Irrational identity politics. Vivek Shunya. Irrational identity politics, free of rationality. Most parties seem to cohere around some form of identity politics, and that seems to be easier in terms of mobilizing votes. But in the process, issues which ought to be center stage in public discussion in a democracy, issues tend to get not only slighted, but in fact ignored altogether insofar as greater public understanding or awareness, even awareness, is concerned.
And basically, Indian languages, by definition, provide for plurality of identities and spaces for all linguistic, cultural, religious, sect identities. But to use them in a fundamentalist way to disregard other dimensions of identity, identity as a consumer, identity as an economic actor, this is being sought to, being done to sort of relegate the demands of a dignified human person. That's why this identity fundamentalism has to be debated. And since majority of the people are either below poverty line or poor, two together, then not talking about these issues and talking about identity in a fundamentalist way is almost political crime. And it is a conspiracy to exclude them from the debates so that they don't The other issue was, I said, was that about global finance capital, they are supposed to make their input. And last one, another point was that we are people from diverse backgrounds. So, and in such a short time, we cannot all make all points which we have. So, each one of you is requested to make what you think is the most crucial point. And the tone tenor doesn't require us to be academic, but politically, as a citizen, what we consider to be the most crucial point, those points you should cover. And in addition to the analytical contribution or critical contribution on the manifesto, the additional suggestions, if it comes from all of you, how post-election time, how shall we take these debates of nation building, different perspective, and our critical view on them to you know, like barber shop and a cobbler's place and ordinary sites in society where people who we are saying are not included in the debate and discourse, who are being sort of reorganized through identity politics, identity anxieties and identity aspirations of various kinds. So how to involve them in the debate? For that, if you have any organizational suggestions, they are also welcome.
Thank you, Vijayji. Should we have one round of introduction?
Quick
name and identity that we represent, or identities that we represent. I'll start. Paul Divakar, National Campaign on Dalit Human Rights, and Vadana Todvarkya.
Vijay Putap, I live in Delhi and nowadays working for World Social Forum Process.
Hello,
Rohit from the Hazards and
Ajay Shah from Delhi.
Benji Sorbeda with an initiative called South South Solidarity and Action.
Rohit from Center for Budget and Governance Accounting.
Sadanand Bhatt from IGSSF, Leader for Social Services.
I am Tasing from Mukhtarantal Government.
Miraj Fatma from Delhi.
Umesh from SATIC.
Arun Bidani, Independent.
Vijay Lakshmi, SATIC.
Ramesh Singh, SATIC.
Vikas Swarup, SATIC.
I am Virat from SATIC.
मेरा नाम प्रकाश कुमार है, मैं कचरा कामगार यूनियन दिल्ली से.
दिन बंधु फ्रॉम पैरिस.
पूजा गुप्ता, इंडियन ऑयल ट्रस्ट, फ्रॉम
पैरिस. आई एम अलोयशियस फ्रॉम एनसीडीएचआर.
एक आदमी फ्रॉम
एनसीडीएचआर. असीम श्रीवास.
Can we have bilingual or
English is fine. Bilingual will take more time. English we can.
If there is somebody who is not following English, then let's say English. What I will do is to make some general comments about all the manifestos that I saw, and I saw four. I did not see the Samajwadi manifesto, but I did read CPM, BJP and Congress manifestos. I'll make some general comments, and that will be most of what I will speak about. And then I will make just a few particular comments, especially in relation to the ARP manifesto. Mainly because in its early stages, I was involved with the policy document that ARP was preparing for this election. But when I read the manifesto of ARP now, I actually do not recognize anything that I read there from what we had actually prepared before the Delhi elections in December. It has been a great learning process for me to understand the limits of electoral politics and the sort of assumptions that are very casually made by political parties when they set about thinking about the country as a whole. And it's become quite transparent to me how the lowest common denominator becomes the norm on the basis of which all good things are going to be achieved in some undetermined future. Let me
begin with the most obvious observation, which I'm sure has struck other people too. All the manifestos are very strong on what they're going to do, but they are virtually silent on how they're going to do it. And related to that, why we are in the mess that we are in, or in the messes that we are in, has not been diagnosed by a single one. One would have imagined that a party like the BJP, if it is in the opposition and is trying to bring the Congress down and liberate India from Congress, as its chief prime ministerial candidate keeps saying, that they would have done their homework as to what has gone wrong fundamentally with the set of policies which have led us to this pass. But of course, they don't do that. The only manifesto I saw which gives some hint of the economic policy framework and what has gone wrong with that is the CPM manifesto. Even the ARP manifesto is completely silent on economic policy. It seems to diagnose everything in terms of the absence of Swaraj and the ubiquity of corruption, and that is a sort of catch-all explanation for all that ails India and so on. So that's a sort of general observation. All the manifestos are strong on what, but not on the why and the how. The second point, and this relates to economic policy, is the obsession, and obsession is the right word, with growth. Now here I'd like to remind ourselves that when you read the constitution of this country, the word growth is conspicuous by its absence from it. I challenge anybody to do a word search in the Constitution of India and find the word growth, especially hitched to that adjective economic growth. It is not there. In fact, economic development as a phrase appears in only two places, in Article 38 and 243. And other than that, even economic development is not present in our Constitution. So the question arises, how did the framers and writers of the Constitution, whether it was Ambedkar or any of the other people in the Constituent Assembly, how did they actually think about this country's problems? And obviously they did not think of this country's problems in terms of the concept of development to begin with. Not Mahatma Gandhi, not Ambedkar, not Tagore, not even Jawaharlal Nehru, actually. So that's a question which we must pose to all the parties. When and how did economic development and economic growth especially become centerpiece of the national agenda? And why? And you can go back to the 1950s, but in terms of the translation of development into growth, you just have to go back to the beginning of the 90s or possibly to the middle of the 1980s, and your answer will be there. So nobody has actually interrogated any of the parties as to why this became so important all of a sudden. Now, in the book that I wrote with Ashish Kothari, we've given an answer as to why growth became so central, and the answer lies in accelerating the growth of the economy in order to increase the returns to financial investment. Fundamentally, I'm simplifying a lot, but fundamentally that is the reason that India and China were both, marked out by Wall Street finance after the 1980s as the future emerging markets, that concept of emerging markets coming from Wall Street and the World Bank, which we have now adopted as though it is our patriotic duty to enable this great market to emerge and for India to become the next superpower, etc. All this was actually somebody else's agenda for us, which we've been made to believe is our agenda. So this is quite a fundamental point, but of course there's total silence about it. Now, as I read our economic history of the last 70 years, and especially of the last 20, 25 years, it's a continuation of colonialism by other means. There was a brief period, roughly 1950 to 1970 at the most, possibly till Nehru's death in 1964, when you could have
imagine the sort of real window of opportunity insofar as an autonomous imagination for a completely new kind of economy and a new kind of society was possible. Both before and after that, it's uninterrupted colonial imagination working through our policy elites, whether it's Mr. Ahluwalia or Mr. Chidambaram or whoever BJP might appoint if they gain office in May. It doesn't matter. The imagination is as colonized as you can think. Now, in concrete terms, what does this mean in terms of the economic policy that the country has been following for the last generation or so? The thing which is determining economic policy in India for a generation, and ultimately it's just one thing, it is how are we going to earn the foreign exchange needed to balance our external account? So if your imports are constantly going to be in excess of your exports, and there is always going to be a trade gap, what goes by current account deficit in the business pages, right? If your current account deficit is always going to be increasing, how are you going to finance it? Because you cannot pay for your oil or your machinery or anything you import from abroad in rupees. You need hard currency. So the answer lies in the fact that there is a capital account in addition to the current account. And that capital account has to do with, you know, loans you take from abroad, investments made by foreigners, etc. And that is the reason why virtually every policy made in the last generation has been designed to invite foreign investment, and why so much debate and hullabaloo in our newspapers about foreign direct investment, most recently in the case of retail, large format retail, and so on. The main concern is that we should be getting enough foreign exchange to be able to pay for imports of oil, otherwise the economy screeches to a halt. That is pretty much what happened in 1991, which is why they went to the IMF in order to contract a large enough loan to finance the external account. So this is very, very fundamental, and it has shaped virtually every major policy step for the last 25 years, as far as I can tell. Interestingly enough, there is no mention of the problem in any of the manifestos. There are hints about it in the Congress and the BJP manifesto, and of course the CPM manifesto is quite a bit more aware of the problem, but it's not spelled out. And the ARP manifesto, there's no discussion of it. The ARP manifesto is written as though we are operating outside an international economic environment. It's astonishing that you can write a manifesto like that and get away with it, imagining that you're not living in global India, you're living in some autarkic India which is not trading with the outside world and which is not carrying out massive financial transactions with the outside world. Right, so that's one set of problems that all the manifestos are afflicted by. The other major absence is the whole question of macroeconomic policy within the economy in the aggregate. Why we discuss macroeconomic policy in the aggregate is because each business, each household, each institution can figure out their own economic plans, but what happens if the overall plans do not match? Then what happens? Now, the kind of problem that India has been having, and again for at least a generation, is this. Inequalities have been growing, and more income, and therefore more and more demand, is getting concentrated in the top layers of the population. In the top 10% and at most the top 20%, but certainly not more than that. Now, that has pretty much dictated the kind of growth the economy will have, to which we are now captive. It has dictated policies towards the poor. It has dictated policies for the rich, etc. Now, why is this a problem? In macroeconomic terms, it's a problem when you have the resources to invest, but you are not sure of the market. Now, in principle, India is a huge market, right? Effectively, India's market is not that big because most people are actually not having the kind of purchasing power which they need to have in order to become a significant player, even in totality, let alone individually. So the narrow base of growth is something which no party comments on in their manifesto. There is no attempt to rectify this macroeconomic imbalance by arguing for various policies which would lead to redistribution of resources, of income, and so on. Excuse me, it's disturbing me. Can I? You can imagine an economy with a growing per capita income, even a very high per capita income, but its growth may not be sustainable in purely macroeconomic terms, let alone environmental terms. In purely macroeconomic terms, it may not be sustainable because if too much of savings are accumulating with the wealthy and they don't know what to do with it except to send it out of the country, okay, then that's a leakage from the income flow within the economy. And they will not know what to do with it beyond the point if the market within the domestic economy is limited. So there has been no attempt to really build the home market from the bottom, something which many economists have been arguing since at least the 1960s. My professor at Delhi School of Economics, Sukumar Chakravarti, used to argue this all the time. And even today, Amit Bhaduri and others have been talking about it. So there's no mention of the problem, and this is not even in the CPM manifesto. Is there mention of the problem of the home market? And so by default, you'll be looking for markets outside, except that you're living in a world economy which is in perpetual recession now. Markets in the West are saturated. Wherever they are possible, China, East Asia, even countries like Indonesia, Bangladesh are miles ahead. So you're not going to be able to export as much as you would like. There is not too much discussion in any of the manifestos of the massive crisis of agriculture. In fact, the Congress manifesto boasts of how we've got 163 million tons of grains being produced, which is a lot, which is 200 kilos per capita annually, which should solve our hunger problem. Actually, you shouldn't need to increase production in order to feed everybody in the country. You don't need the second green revolution. None of that is necessary given the amount of production, but nobody is getting into the question of the distribution of food fundamentally and why that is not working in the direction it should be working in. There is an agrarian crisis, both in terms of the destruction of smallholder agriculture and in terms of what has happened to the ecology of agriculture, in terms of the contamination and salinization of the soils, the depletion of groundwater, multiple and many problems related to that, the depletion of agrobiodiversity. Some of these things get a token mention in some of the manifestos, but broadly, the problem is, again, pushed aside. It's a very, very serious problem, and just to give you a sense of why I think it's a very serious problem for the future, consider this. So the general trajectory of economic development in any society in the modern world is meant to go something like this. In the beginning, you have a lot of people working in the primary sector, that is to say in agriculture and allied activities. Over a period of time, people start moving from agriculture to industry and services. And after a few generations, you find most people are actually working in industry and services. Now, in India, it turns out this has not happened. And in our book, we give about five reasons why this is not going to happen in India. But the planning and the thinking of all the policy elites and the parties is as though this is happening and as though it's inevitable even in the future. So let's take their argument for the sake of it. Let's take their assumption for the sake of it and think through what they are saying.
So what Mr. Modi or Mr. Chidambaram or anybody is really saying at the top is, we want to move 80 or 85% of India to the cities by 2030 or 2035. Suppose they succeed. मान लीजिए कि उनको इस बात में सफलता मिल जाती है, what is going to happen? So now you brought up a whole generation which is not only unwilling to do manual agriculture, it is ill-equipped, it lacks the ability, the skills to do manual agriculture. So you have an agriculture which is now mechanized, which is to say largely controlled by agribusiness, which means heavily fossil fuel fed in a time of peak oil, peak coal, peak gas, etc. So depleting energy and shrinking climate space. So you have a situation where a generation from now, you do not know how you're going to feed 1.5 billion people. Now, if the argument goes that we're going to import this food, name the part of the world which can produce this volume of food, which can give you an ecological substitute for the Indo-Gangetic Plain, etc. I mean, you can just push that line of thinking on any of these people, and they have not thought this through, right? So this is one in many ways, one among many ways how you can actually map the complexity of the agrarian crisis, especially in the context of the plans afoot to actually get people out of agriculture. And the whole theory that productivity is falling because of breakup of big holdings into small holdings and so on, all that, there is data to challenge all of that. Global data actually shows the exact opposite, which is that beyond a certain point, productivity falls with the size of the farm. The bigger the farm after a certain point, the lower the productivity per unit of land. Right. Coming to a few more observations which are common to all the manifestos, they all talk about generation of employment, but the how of how it's going to be done, not spelled out. Even something like the importance of medium, small, and micro enterprises, while it's present in the BJP and the Congress manifesto and the CPM manifesto, it's not mentioned, by the way, in the ARP manifesto, interestingly enough. How that is to be actually promoted? How are you going to arrange large volumes of small credit? Now, nobody's interested in giving you a 1 crore or a 5 crore loan anymore. People want to give you a 30, 40, 50, 100, 500 crore loan for all sorts of reasons. So how are you going to arrange financing for those things? Why have 10% of the MSMEs in Gujarat shut down in the last 5 years? If the Gujarat model is actually a viable model of job generation, then why has this happened? Etc. None of these questions are probed. Crafts, handicrafts, for instance, mentioned in some of the manifestos. Again, the ARP manifesto does not talk about it. This is after we've had discussions in which I have suggested that of the 800 odd crafts that are listed by the government of India, we should think about, you know, seeing them as industry, redefining them as industry. Get them the kind of state support that industry normally gets in order to generate employment. And if you're not going to focus on, you know, this sector, how the hell are you going to generate jobs? Congress says in the manifesto that in manufacturing alone, they're going to generate 10 crore jobs in the next 10 years. It's a mystery. It's a complete mystery to me how they produce these numbers. When I was doing research on SEZs, and we had interrogated Mr. Kamal Nath about it when he was industry minister, and the whole thing is poppycock. I mean, the whole, any number that you see in terms of generation of jobs is not worth believing, just like most of the poverty data is not worth believing. Right, I should be winding up. One important thing which I had tried to introduce into the ARP discussion was about integrating economic and environmental policy. Now, normally the way policy is made, not only in this country but in most parts of the world, is first you plan for the economy, and in the space and time and resources left over, you think about the environment. And which is why I distinguish very sharply between an ecological vision and an environmental vision.
most policy elites have an environmental vision in which the environment is just an afterthought to the economy. We don't have the luxury to entertain these assumptions and prejudices anymore. And it's time that we thought about environment and economy as a whole from the start. Otherwise, we will be overtaken by ecological events and no party or program can ever catch up with what's going to happen. So I had tried to argue this in the ARP discussions, and initially it was there in the document. Now it is not there, except that the term economy ecology has been retained, but there's no follow-up thinking around it. One good thing I noticed in the Congress manifesto, and I should mention this, it's just a promise, again, no indication as to how it's going to happen, but at least it's mentioned that from 2016-17 onwards, they will try to do green accounting. And there is a good report by the Parthadas Gupta Committee, which was set up by the Prime Minister last year, which has very, very radical suggestions. I will contemplate the seriousness of it if you actually work it out, and if those suggestions, even half of those suggestions, are actually put into practice, you might find that growth rates are actually going into the negative domain, properly measured. I mean, the World Bank last year in July came out with a report, quite an authoritative report, which shows that India is losing 5.7% of its GDP every year to environmental losses, and not all the losses are taken into account. For instance, climate change and many other dimensions are ignored. But even ignoring all that, 5.7% of our GDP is getting lost every year. So which is effectively, at present rates, more than neutralizing the economic growth. So if green accounting is done, I think the markets will dip south, and various and many things are going to happen which you don't want to see. You don't want to know about those things. You want to go on with the illusion of the growth process. Right. On the plus side, I should mention that ARP is the only manifesto which actually talks about Swaraj in a serious way, and talks about Gram Sabhas and Mohalla Sabhas, and talks about how even to exploit minerals, you should get the consent of the Gram Sabha and stuff. It also asks for a clearer definition of public purpose when it comes to land acquisition, and again, something which Congress and BJP manifestos don't say anything about. It asks for a reduction of the contractualization of labor, the casualization of labor, which CPM document also talks about it. I will close by saying that I tried to do a thought experiment as to what might happen if the seemingly inevitable actually happens, which is Mr. Modi becomes Prime Minister in May. I think he will be moily in a hurry, except that he will realize that running an actual economy of India's size is not the same as running Gujarat. The common confusion in all these parties and all the policy elites is that green tape is the same as red tape, that environmental clearances are a nuisance which should be done away with, and all this catchy language about single window clearance and so on. They can try that. They can try that for a while at the national level, but I think he will be bumping against the same constraints the Congress did, if not more. And the reason I say more is because people's movements around the country have been growing, and people are absolutely mad as hell. So I don't see Modi actually getting away with it. I don't think he'll be able to do Gujarat in India, so I don't have any fear on that count. However, given the high amount of economic literacy within the BJP, as reflected in their manifesto and in other policy pronouncements, the likelihood of them mismanaging the macroeconomy is probably greater than the Congress. And don't forget that the Congress has been running this country for the better part of 65, 70 years, so they actually, their economists and policy wonks actually know something about the way things actually are done. With the BJP,